Shoot.
Mary can start.
It's on. Yeah, I wanted to start out. This is Father's Day, June 17th, 2007. And we wanted to sit down with Mom and Dad and interview them and ask them some questions. We thought maybe we would start out first, instead of starting with Dad's childhood, maybe ask some questions about your courtship. No, we wanted to talk about how you met Grandma.
Mom.
And how Mom remembers her first meeting. So we'll start, and I'll first ask Dad the same question, and then we'll ask Mother's perspective. So,
seems like I've known her all my life.
I know. So what was, how did you meet Grandma?
You got the camera on?
Mm-hmm.
How did I meet her? Probably over to her house in Newton. You think so?
This is just your opinion. You're supposed to remember. Okay, so, if you don't remember the first meeting, tell your perspective of how you started becoming interested in her and dating her.
What, was it through Ralph that you first met Mom, or how was it?
I said, I don't remember.
I can remember that they moved to Trenton and he was going to North Cache. He was a senior and I was a sophomore.
She was the same age as my
brother
Boyd.
No, I was a freshman. Huh? You were a junior and I was a freshman. And so I knew him from North Cache. And then when he went to college, both he and my brother Ralph, Marcus, everybody calls him today, both went into engineering, and he used to come over to Grandma Cooley's to study with Ralph sometimes. But one time I invited him to go on a girl's choice date with me. And I don't know how he got a car to go.
You know how I what?
How you were able to get a car to go at that time.
I borrowed it from my dad.
Well, he was in, was he still in Trenton at that time?
Yes.
He might have been, I guess. And
the only reason I went to North Cache, because we moved from Iona to Trenton.
And so that was the first date we went on, but then we didn't go on any more dates until after I started college.
I didn't return a date very fast because lack of transportation.
And Grandma Cooley used to say that she thought first that he just came over to study with Ralph, but after a while she thought maybe he came over to see me. And he started asking me on dates. I don't remember particularly the very first date that we went on at Utah State, because we went on quite a few.
So what was a favorite date you went on? Most memorable, Dad?
Well, from memories, is the time that I asked her to go, three of us knew me, Tedburn Heisel. Was it Tedburn Heisel and Ralph and I? We decided to take, get a date for, was it Easter Sunday?
Mm-hmm.
Easter Sunday, and I didn't have much money, so I talked all the guys in, let's not buy flowers for all the girls, I can't afford it. And so, I don't remember whether we picked up the other two girls, but there were three of us, with dates, six of us in the car. And I went up and knocked on the door to get Marble. She was already, and she came to the door, and there's a flower out in our backyard there called a gardenia. She came out with three or four gardenias in a big corsage. And I had to talk all my roommates into, don't get any flowers for this occasion.
So
and they
he could asked have
killed me.
So he asked me, where did I get it? And I said, well, you sent it to me. And he says, no, I didn't. It came with no card.
I should have set up
that morning. So the next day I called and found out it had been ordered by a fellow, remember whether he was a Marine or an Air Force guy, that had left like a month or 6 weeks before.
Good timing.
Isn't that the Easter Sunday? We have pictures of Ralph and Elma and you and Dad, those little teeny ones that we found.
Sure.
It was on Easter Sunday.
If I have a croissant, coming in.
I don't remember who the three fellows
I
were.
I can remember one memorable date that we went on. We went to a dance. It was not unusual, but we went to a formal dance. At that time, the Institute had dances up at the Institute, and this was during the winter time, and they hired a taxi cab to take us up there, but when we came out, we couldn't, there were too many all ordering taxi cabs at the same time, and we couldn't get one, so we had to walk home, and...
Only about a mile to her house.
But it was the road from the Institute, the sidewalk from the Institute down was real steep, and so we were slipping and sliding down this road with me in a formal dress.
So did you catch her?
I think we fell down a couple of times.
Oh, did you catch her?
I don't sure remember.
I did catch her.
Another memorable date I remember that we went out on, and we were going over to their apartment. I think it was their apartment to eat afterwards or something.
And, we have
as we went in
apartment.
The day, as we went in the door, he said, it was real dark, and he said, stand still, don't move. All I did was I reached out my arm, and I happened to be standing right in front of the stairway, and as I reached out my arm, I fell, and
she
I fell all
balance.
The way down, I lost my balance and slid down the stairway, and there was an ironing board at the bottom of the stairway, and my feet got caught up in the ironing board, and I said, don't turn on the light.
Her dress was for up here, sir. But we didn't go in the front door because the guys had locked the front door. And my gentle stairway, we went around the back door, and it was a steep stairway down, and then it turned. But she fell halfway down the stairs with her, at least one of her foot or both of them up in the top of the ironing board.
So when did you decide to ask Mom to marry her? How long
I
had you dated?
I never did ask her.
You never did? Well, how did you decide to get married?
Huh? I just put a ring on her.
Oh!
He never ever did tell me that he loved me all the time that we dated. And then he went back to North Carolina to go to a training school. And he called me up at Christmas time, I think it was, and I was out on a date when he called. And... But he left word for me to call him back, and I think it was midnight by the time I got back, and by the time I called him, it was probably
2 o'clock in the morning back there.
I called him, and he talked to me for just, it was really expensive to call in those days, and so he called me, and he answered, and he talked to me for just a few minutes, and then he says, I love you, and I said, are you sure? And, and he didn't. I guess he answered and stuff, and so I waited and waited for the next letter to come, and it never mentioned a thing. So I didn't know what to think. And then when he was coming home, my dad said, he wrote and asked me to come down to Kaysville. And my dad said, well, I'm not letting you go. But then Lloyd was home at the same time, and Lloyd called up and said that he had come up to pick up Elaine, and he said, Dave wants me to bring Marvel down. So Dad said, well, I guess if Lloyd's going to take you down, it'll be okay. And when we got down there...
We were living in Kaysville then.
At that time, the next morning after we got there, he came in the bedroom after I was dressed, and he kissed me, and he pulled my arm around to the back, and he put the ring on it. And without even waiting for me to hardly even see it, he took my arm and rushed me into the kitchen.
No, I gave
where
you a kiss for
where his mother was.
Thanks for putting the right details there.
And he held out my hand to show her, and she said, well, you're not going to get married for a long time, are you? And he said,
no, not until Wednesday.
No, he said Wednesday, and so did she.
Well, I didn't even ask her, but...
So,
I bet you never heard anybody propose like that, though.
I haven't.
Huh?
He didn't even give her time to answer.
So you had it all fixed, figured out in your mind exactly how it needed to be then before you asked Mom, or before you gave her the ring.
What's that now?
You had it all figured out in your head how it was needed to be.
Where did you get the ring? Was it in...
I bought it.
I know, but in North... Was it back east, or did you buy it here in Utah?
Back in east.
I mean, in Utah.
You know how I knew what size it was? Because when I was dating her one day, she was wearing her class ring, and I took it off and tried it on all my fingers to see about how far it would go on my fingers, so I knew what size it was, unless I'd gained weight.
I didn't remember him doing that.
So you've been kind of planning it since before you went back then? If you were trying it on for size?
My brother, Ralph, told me when he came home ahead of David, and he said, don't count on David. He's dating girls all the time. Don't wait for him.
So that's why Mom was on a date when he called her.
Yeah.
So, Dad, I remember you telling me what your very favorite song was at that time. Do you remember what you told me? I was asking you what song you liked, one of your favorite songs.
I don't remember.
Do you remember a song called Me and My Gal?
Yes.
Judy Garland sang that at the time. Do you remember it, Mom?
Yeah, we went to a show and she sang it in the show.
That's why it hits.
So that's Grandma's and Grandpa's theme song.
Well, I remember, I don't know if you taped it before, Mom and Dad have told me before, but the story of where Dad was on the day that Pearl Harbor was bombed and how both of you heard the news.
What's that mean?
Thumbing.
Huh?
Hitchhiking.
Hitchhiking.
Yeah.
Thumbing a ride.
Wade and I were hitchhiking. I hitchhike more than anyone I know of. We lived in Kaysville and we'd go home on weekends. And going home on weekends, we would hitchhike from Logan to Kaysville. Then on Sunday afternoon, we'd hitchhike from Kaysville back to Logan. And one day, I don't know the one time we were hitchhiking, up in Ogden, out of Five Points, and a car came by, he had fell and his wife. And didn't pick us up. I said, Lloyd, you know, that car's been by here three times. And about that time, it pulled on, stopped about 100 feet from us, and they signaled for us to come over there. We went over, and first they said, do you have a driver's license? Yes. Could we see it? Yes. And then, after talking to us to a few minutes, he says, would you drive my wife up to Logan? Because he didn't want to take her up there, so we took him home and took her car, and I took his car and her, and Lloyd and I took this woman up to Logan. He was going to come up the next weekend and get her because she didn't drive.
Did you know that Five Points, I live right by that intersection right now?
I know that real well.
I didn't know that that's where you were hitchhiking from. I could walk right there. It's a block away from where I'm living.
I'll tell you another time, too.
Well, finish telling us you drove up there and then...
One summer, before I went into the service, while we were still in school, I guess maybe I was a junior then, and Marva went down to Ogden and went to work for somebody. Who was it? You were living with your aunt down there? What was it?
With Mark? And Uncle Mark and Aunt Elizabeth, and I was working out on 2nd Street doing secretarial work for our company. $120 a month.
That's for big wages.
Yeah.
I only got $150 a month when I was in the service. The first year, I only got $66 a month.
Well, you were going to tell them about this other time that you were hitchhiking.
When I was hitchhiking where? Well, that was after we were married.
No, when you were hitchhiking to see your aunt.
Oh. Well, that's not like personal modern life. I was hitchhiking, and I got picked up by three guys in a car. I was hitchhiking from Kaysville to Boise to go up and see my aunt before I went into the service. And when we stopped at Twin Falls, the guys said they'd take us to dinner, and somewhere along the line, I asked this fellow sitting in the back seat with me, I said, what do you do for a living? He says, I peddle drugs. I said, how'd you get away with it? He says, I didn't. Those are the federal marshals in the front. I'm going to prison.
That's pretty funny.
Huh?
That's pretty funny.
Can you imagine picking up a stranger with a prisoner in the car, and they were sitting in front. I could have put a gun in the back of their head.
I think he was in his uniform.
Oh, I was in a uniform, and they picked me up.
Okay, funny. But what do you remember? You were telling us when you were hitchhiking on December 7th about Pearl.
Well, that's what we started out to tell you. It was on a Sunday. We were hitchhiking back from Kaysville to Logan, and somewhere along the way, after we got picked up probably there in Ogden at Five Points, announcement came over the radio that the Japanese had bombed Pearl Harbor.
That was a real shock to everybody.
And that was before you were married. That was before you went into the service and everything. So,
well, he was in ROTC, though.
Yeah.
So, Dad, tell me a little bit about what made you want to choose Mom for your girl. What were some of the things that you really fell in love with Mom?
Good looking, beautiful, smart. Well, she thought it was like to beat the competition, I hoped.
So what made you choose her over all the other girls you're dating?
I never even had an idea of marrying any of them.
Okay. She was the only one, Mom. I mean, you were the only one. So what made you fall in love with Dad?
I don't know for sure at that time. It was because, like I said, we never really discussed anything much like that. But it was interesting to me later on as we started looking at some old videos of Aunt Marie's that she had taken, that Dad happened to be up in Newton in the picture. And this was before we'd ever gotten married or anything else. It was really, I thought, I wonder why he was up to Newton that time in that picture.
Yeah.
So.
How do you date without a car?
That's pretty amazing this day.
You walk every place. You walk to the dances. We'd go to Friday night dances down at the Donson. And occasionally, I don't even, maybe a picture show once in a while.
Do you remember any of the music you danced to or what kind of dances you did?
Dad was not a very good dancer. I liked to go because he traded dances with some of the other
fellows. I traded dances.
Some of his friends.
But he liked the music, huh?
Yeah, he treated me nice.
The Donson is the one that you painted.
Yeah.
We had a few difficulties, though. I waited and waited for him to ask me to go to the...
Well, don't tell that story.
The junior prom, and he didn't ever ask me. He asked another girl.
Yeah, but I've heard about you dating that other boy a lot. Too, or didn't you have a
Salisbury? Was he your boyfriend?
Oh,
there's
not
pictures
sure.
Of you with him.
Yeah.
Well, she even asked me one time. I thought she might like. One time, she even showed me a ring that another guy had given her, and she wanted to know what she should do about it. I said, "Give it back to him."
I didn't show it to you.
Yes, you did. At least you told me you had it up in your dresser.
Well, I gave it back to
him. She followed my advice.
Twice, I
all
think.
Right.
Well, that shows right there. You must have some interest or concern.
So, tell us a little bit about your wedding.
Well, my mother, you know, it amazes me when I think back. We had to go, you had to have a blood test before you could get married. And so, we went up to Ogden and he talked some.
Nobody told us it took us 10 days to get
a license. And he talked the doctor into giving us the blood test and how to get it tested fast. And so we got the blood test.
Took it over to the lab where they did it and waited there and said, how long it'll take? Oh, 2 or 3 days. How fast can you get it done? How long does it take to do it? Well, we need it today.
And then
so we cut that 10 days down from Was it Monday we went up there?
Yeah. And then we went over and got the license. Did we get it there, or did we go and load it again?
I think we got it there.
And then we went up to see my dad, who was teaching school.
I needed to ask his hand or approval.
But you already had this preparation in place.
And he said, well, you couldn't get married that fast anyway. And he said, oh, that's all taken care of.
Here's the license. How'd you do it in 2 days when it takes 10 days in Utah?
And then we went over.
Well, first, what did he say to me?
Not then.
Was it then?
It was after we'd gone home. We went over and told Mom and wondered down the road we'd ever make arrangements to do anything by Wednesday. But then my dad asked him a question while I was over there.
Go ahead and tell us that.
Dad answered that one.
Have you ever thought about joining the church? Or would you consider joining the church? I don't remember what the question led up to. I said I would read the Book of Mormon. And if I believed it, I probably would. But that was good enough for him. So he arranged to have their stake president perform the wedding ceremony over at Grandma Cooley's house there on
72
2nd North, is it?
By the temple.
172 East 3rd North.
The White House.
Mm-hmm. Because Grandpa couldn't come over to our place, and this was in February, he went back home, and then Mother and I went out, and somehow we found that wedding dress. I don't know how we found a wedding dress in one day.
And tell me, how much was it in those days?
I don't remember.
At least $1.
I was thinking you had said $25, but I'm not sure. Is that correct?
It could be, but I don't remember exactly.
I didn't have $25.
Well, he didn't buy it. My mother did. And then she got the lady across the street to make a wedding cake for us.
So how much did the ring cost then, Dad?
What?
How much did the ring cost, do you remember?
Oh, that's a secret.
Yeah. Did you buy it back east, or did you?
We bought it back in North Carolina.
That's what I was wondering, if you bought it. I forgot to ask you, what was the story about your dad getting a telegraph, something over the telegraph?
Well, that was after we were married.
Okay, tell me what that was.
Well, Dad was a railroad telegrapher. He used to send messages by da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da.
Well, we made up this.
He could listen to three or four of those machines, just like three or four of you in the room, and you could all be talking at once, and he could listen to all of them, and just as plain as we're talking words.
Yeah.
Anyway, we sent a letter, we sent a telegram to her brother saying that...
Well, we started it out by saying, engaged on Sunday, maybe home on Saturday, engaged on Sunday, licensed on Monday.
We were engaged on Sunday.
That's what I said. And licensed on Monday and...
Or examined on Monday.
We had every day of the week, and then married on Wednesday, and I guess honeymoon on Thursday. And then we went down to Kingsville. I can't remember. Separating on Sunday.
And Dad heard that, and he sat down in his typewriter and wrote out the whole message. Confidential in those days.
We were sending it to my brother Ralph, who was in the service back in...
So he didn't even know you'd gotten married, huh? Oh, my goodness.
He knew that I would never get married.
that's a cute story. That's
so funny. Ralph had no confidence in you ever getting Mom and marrying her, huh?
No.
But Ralph was your really good friend, right?
Yes.
Yeah. And he was going to engineering school, too.
Yeah.
And
mm-hmm. He was older than I was, though.
Grandma Cooley came
couple
to me
months,
and
right?
said, I like David better than any of the other fellows you're going with.
Mary Ellen, Grandma Cooley.
This was before we ever...
Is this your mother or your grandmother?
My grandmother.
Oh.
And anyway, she liked David. And, it was interesting. The Christmas before, he bought me a gift and he gave it to her to hide it and
under the Christmas tree.
Put it some way, give it to the folks to put it under the Christmas tree. And I wanted to buy something for him. And David, my brother, said, "Oh, David hasn't bought a thing for you, so I wouldn't buy him anything. It would just be embarrassing."
He went downtown with me when I bought the present, but I didn't let him know I was buying it.
It's helpful to have an older brother that didn't always know the facts.
Okay, I want to know about the first kiss. Do you remember the first kiss?
Yes, I do.
Okay, tell us about it.
You tell him.
You tell him. You're the one who remembers.
Well, I'll tell you. The Institute, they had a, I don't know if they called it a sorority or a fraternity, but it was a social organization. They called it the Lambda Delta Sigma, LDS. And I wanted to know how you could join them. LDS. And Milton Hunter, I think he ended up being the quorum of 70, but anyway, he was a professor there at the Institute there at Logan. I went and asked him. He said, "Well, you have to be living the word of wisdom." Well, I'm doing that. And you have to know the articles of faith. What about member of the church? No, but you have to be taking a class at the Institute. And so I went home and memorized the Articles of Faith that night, went back, and oh, you had to pay $1 to join the organization. So I went back and gave him $1 and said the Articles of Faith and signed up for taking a class in the New Testament.
Oh, my word. That was all before you ever even read the Book of Mormon, huh?
Mm-hmm. And then they, like Mom said, they had dances up there and parties, and I don't remember.
And we went to church up there, too.
That's something I never knew.
Okay. So when did you...
So keep going about the first kiss.
Well, I don't remember exactly, but I know it was going up the stairs down at the Institute. No one was around. And
you just met and kissed? Or okay, we need a little more details.
No, we were probably on a date there.
We were on
dance.
A date.
Okay.
I'd taken her to the dance or whatever it was then.
And you were taking her back home?
No, at least I had enough friends that knew how to dance that she was willing to go with me.
Well, it might have been that we were just going out or coming in or something.
You know how
and
it was.
He just reached around and kissed me, I think.
I never did get such a low grade as I did in that dancing class.
I remember you telling me that.
I think I got a C out of it. The only C I remember.
Dance lessons up here from Beth and Burgess Robinson. He never could.
Do you think it's because you couldn't hear the music as well?
No. I think he just didn't have an innate sense. He did not have an innate sense of rhythm or something.
Well, I always thought he was fun to dance with. I talked about that in my little tribute. Yeah. I remember Dad letting me step on his toes and he'd dance with me.
You'd be right on top of
he
toes.
Did, but we always did the same step over and over and over
again. Well, it must have worked.
It was the two-step, right?
He didn't learn to do the ones where you twirl around and
do the ones where they're the good dancers.
Better dancers.
So I remember
okay.
dancing the two-step.
Can I ask him something
about
his childhood?
Well, let me just backtrack just a tiny bit. While you were at Utah State, tell me a couple of stories that I wanted to have clarified. When you were one of the engineering students, you were telling me some story about the cow, bringing a cow up the stairs, or...
That had nothing to do with our marriage.
I know. Now we're going on to a new subject.
There was a real competition between the foresters and the engineers. And we went over to the forestry building, and they had Paul Bunyan was their symbol or idol, and it was up on top of the,
like a mascot.
On top of the forestry building. And it was our job to get that Paul Bunyan down from there. I don't think we got it down that day, but we ended up getting it down. I don't remember the details of it. Anyway, we did get the Paul Bunyan down some night and took it over and put it on top of the up on the engineering building and put a rope around its neck and was hanging it out over in front of the But the night that we went over there, we were trying to get up on the roof to get that Paul Bunyan. We didn't care how we got it down, and I don't remember where they got it down that night. But one of the foresters got away, and they were having a forestry party over at the cafeteria. And there were only about a dozen of us, and there were only a half dozen of us. And these foresters come running over there while we were in the building. And I thought, boys, I'm going to be captured. I've got to figure out how to get out of here. And I was the only one that escaped. What I did, somebody went over to get the fire extinguisher, and I said, don't let them ruin our building with this fire extinguisher. A forestry building. They thought I was a forester. There's so many they didn't know. And so then I went down the basement and opened the window, crawled out the window and took off. The rest of them got caught there. And they took all their pants off. All of them had to go home without any pants. And then the next week at the assembly, they brought out all the guys' pants and they had to come cleaning. And in those days, you could only afford one pair of pants. So they all went out to get their pants, but I never had to because I didn't lose mine. Anyway, we went ahead and got the Paul Bunyan up there. But what the foresters did then, they came over to the engineering building, and somehow they got in there and they got a cow and got it up onto the second or third floor of the building. They could get the cow to go up the stairs, but for us to try to get that cow to go down the stairs was a real job, but we did it. I think we had to make it back down.
That's funny. And what about the time you climbed up on Old Main?
What?
About climbing up on top of Old Main. Why did you do that?
Oh, to earn some money.
Oh.
I got a picture of Old Main. It's got a flagpole up on the top. Wayne Christensen, he was a champion swimmer for the Utah Aggies, and he got the job of painting that screen up there. I think he got $30 for doing it. He couldn't get anyone to go up on the roof of that thing up on that point.
Painting the pole, wasn't it?
Painting the flagpole. And the flag, you know, you pull the ropes and pull it down, but he had to go up to the top of the pole and paint it. And boy, he's a big, heavy guy. Like a couple hundred pounds or more. And he climbed the pole up there, and then, of course, you have to paint the pole starting at the top. And I went up on the point, and I had to give him the paint bucket and tie the rope on it when he pulled it up. I didn't have to go grip on the pole. I just had to sit straddle the pole on the top of the Old Main. So we got the pole painted and I got $5 for doing my part. He got the $25.
That's great. Okay, I'm going to put a flash right here just on the camera so we know where we're going to start a new little section. It'll be easier to see. We're going to backtrack now, Dad, and Mina wants to start with asking some questions about your childhood, and Barbara's asleep on us. And
I think I was just thinking about your childhood and some of your earliest memories of your home, the feelings you remember in your home growing up, Dad, and what. Another one, just this will be a separate question, but if you want to go on to it, is what's one of the most special days you remember spending with your dad? And also, do you remember a really special day involving something with your mother?
I remember the first day the day I was born. As soon as I was born, they put me in the oven to keep me warm.
Although you don't remember it, you remember being told.
I do remember.
You about roasting.
They told me the details, I remember.
Okay, but what were your...
Now, why did they put you in the oven?
Because it was cold. They didn't have... It was cool like it is like here today.
They were waiting for the doctor.
On June the 29th.
But what do you remember... What memories, what are the earliest memories you have of what it was like in your home with your mom and dad? Or a smell, a feeling that you had in the home? Probably your earliest memory, you'd already have a younger brother or sister.
We lived in Payette where I was born, and Boyd was born over in Cuna, a few miles away. And I remember that age, I was a couple years old, and I remember that I used to like to gather wagons. If I could pull wagons, and I'll get the neighborhood wagons, and I'd go pull all the wagons down and pull them up to my front yard.
You'd go collect them all, huh? You'd go collect everybody's wagon.
I collected everybody's wagon on our front. And then there was a little girl by the name of Bernadine Bussey. I don't know what she is, if she's still alive or not, but she, probably not. She'd be 90 years old now.
She was about
6 years old. And I liked to ride the tricycle behind her. She had a tricycle, and I could stand on the pedal, not the pedal,
the platform.
The platform right between the back wheels and hold on to the seat there, and she'd give me a ride down to the drugstore, and I could go down there, and we could each get a ice cream cone for a nickel apiece.
What was your home like there in Kuna?
I don't remember. It was a small house with very little furniture in it.
Which was the box car? Where was that?
Iona.
Where did you lived in a box car?
No. Well,
yeah, there. One of the houses was a box car. I've got a picture of it. It was an old railroad box car.
Wasn't that when you lived in Iona with your family?
No, that was the depot.
It was
somewhere in Boise.
Maybe an orchard we lived in.
Yeah. Because I've got pictures of it, and they actually mounted the box car, and then they put little things on it. But we have pictures of you living in the box car.
I remember there were a bunch of wild horses that come in, and the water tank leaked, and there was always a pond there, and the wild horses had come in there to get drink water every morning or late at night.
Is this an orchard, you said?
Huh?
Or Kuna, is his earliest
horses.
Memories.
Where?
Indian ponies about
in
that.
Kuna or Iona or
where were you living when you're telling this story?
An orchard.
Okay, that's what I was asking.
So you do remember orchard. Okay.
And I think we were living at orchard when my sister Betty was born.
Well, what they asked you was how was the feeling in your home between your family, your mother and your dad and your kids and
what were some of your family traditions? Did your dad come home for dinner every night? Was it?
I don't remember. We got fed all the time.
Were there any favorite foods that your mom made for you?
Peanut butter sandwiches.
Did she mix honey in it back then? Because as a kid, Grandma always mixed honey into the peanut butter.
I think so.
Did she make lots of soups? I mean, that's my memory of her, is her always having soup on the stove.
Never really concerned about what I had to eat, as long as I got something to eat.
Okay, so I'm going to backtrack and get some details. So you were born in Payette, and then you moved to where after Payette?
Quite a few places. Dad got moved all the time, but probably the next place we moved was over to Kuna, K-U-N-A. That's where Lloyd was born. I think we were living at Orchard when Betty was born.
Okay.
Well, I remember we had an old model. Oh, the interesting thing, I think it was when we lived at Orchard, we got an old Model T car then. She learned to drive, and she would take the lunch down to Dad at the depot. And I remember riding with her one day, and
your mom drove.
Yes, at that time.
Yes.
She drove down there, and before then they had horse and buggies, you know, and they drove down there, and she got 50 feet or so away from the depot where they parked, and she had to hold the steering wheel. She said, "Whoa, whoa, whoa, that car wouldn't stop. Whoa, whoa." She must hit the brake a little bit because we just bumped into the depot a little bit. And she says, "I'm never going to drive a car again."
She never did.
And that's why I got to learn to drive. I became her chauffeur when I was 12 years old. I started driving the car when I was 12, out of Iona.
Did you tell me you used to like to go out and warm it up or back it up, or what was it that you did?
Oh, at Iona. We had a Model A then, a four-door Model A. And we'd come to Idaho Falls to do our shopping, and we were in a hurry to go to Idaho Falls one day, and Dad said, "Oh, I wish David was big enough to drive. He said, we're going to be late. I knew where his keys were, so I got the keys, and it was about a quarter of a block, oh, maybe 400 or 500 feet away from the railroad station where we were living in the railroad station. So I went down there, got in it, and started it, and put it in reverse, and backed it up, and you had to really squeeze by there. And I drove it up and parked it right where Daddy used to park it and got in. And I says, "Your wish is granted," or something like that. "Here's the keys to your car. The car's out front." And from that day on, and I think he might have taken me out and give me another lesson or something, because the first lesson was all by myself by watching how he did the shifting of this gears.
A little different from today, just going on and turning on the car and putting it in reverse.
Tell us about your homes. You told me once you did not have any indoor plumbing until they bought the home in Kaysville, which was when you were in college.
We didn't have plumbing, and I think we probably had, can't remember, and pay up, but we probably had some plumbing there in the bathroom, but when we went to Orchard, we didn't have plumbing. Dad did bid in a job down at Salt Lake City, and he bought a house at 754 Parker's Lane. And we went down there and visited that. I think which kids I took down there to see that. I think it was maybe it was Jordan and Megan. I took them by there one time, showing where the house was. But,
is it when you were at that house, is that when you were, which house, where were you, and you went out and there was a cesspool?
You were sleepwalking?
That was in Sandy. They lived just a few blocks from the school there. And when we moved there, they had the people that we met in the house, they put in a kitchen sink. They had running water in the house. And they did not have any septic tank or sewer to empty the water out of the kitchen sink, except they dug a big hole. It was 6 to 8 feet deep. Uh-huh. And nothing around it to keep people from falling in it or anything. And we'd only been there a few days, and I was out the back, and Dad was in the house, and I went up to the edge of that, and a voice said to me, "David, don't go near there. Don't go near that." And I thought it was Dad telling me. And so I went in and said something to Dad. He didn't know what I was talking about. I didn't say anything to him. I just felt that I heard the Holy Ghost tell me, "Stay away from that." So right after that, Dad took actions to get a lid over that place. Otherwise, if I'd fallen in there, never could have got out. It just steep hole. And, one thing I remember there, I did sleepwalking.
And this was in Salt Lake still?
No, Sandy.
Sandy, I meant.
In Sandy, I went to the first, second, and third grade. And my dad came down when I was in the first grade. He came down and built a playhouse in the school room in our first grade room.
Oh, my word.
And got some scrap lumber and built it, and the teacher and the principal let him come in there, and we did. Huh. And then also when I was there, I always wanted to take a lunch there. You know, but I only lived a couple of blocks away from school, about like from here down to John Adams, away from the school, so I always had to come home for lunch. And one day, I was there in the classroom, and my dad brought by our lunch, the paper bag. Was I ever thrilled that I could go out and sit on the bleacher by the field there, where the baseball field was, I guess. And I went out there with the kids to sit down to open up my package of lunch, and guess what was in it?
Your boots,
galoshes.
My overshoes, so I could walk home because it was raining. I didn't let anybody see that I had them, and I just took off and went home. I didn't put the boots on. I just went home without them.
So was it that was it that Grandma tried to conserve money by having you eat at home, or she just?
No, you just lived so close.
I know, but
I
just.
Think so.
But she didn't know that you really wanted to eat there.
Yeah, I had another close call. They had it there in the city there, where they had a pond, well, maybe the size of our lot here, about a half acre, and they had a fire hydrant on one end, and they just opened that hose up, or nozzle, and then it'd shoot water out into the pond, and then it'd freeze over, but right where they put the water into it, it was always water in there, because they had put more water and let it go out over the ice. And one day, right after Christmas, I got a sled. And I went down there, and the kids, the bigger kids, were hooked a rope on my sled and was pulling me around. And then, play smart, they weren't speeding, skating, and they let my sled go. And I couldn't turn it fast enough, and I went right into that water. I went down under the ice and got back out of it. It was cold because it was freezing. And I went home. I think the time I got home, the three blocks.
Oh, I'm amazed you got out.
And then another story there. Some people raised chicken. They had one place that had a bunch of baby chickens, little incubators. And these incubators had electric heaters to keep them warm. And a couple of times they called the fire department because they were having an overheating and building was about catching on fire. And one day I went by there and the guy said, David, would you go? We were one of the few people who had a phone number on. Would you go home and call the fire department? That had happened about three times and I went home and I forgot to call the fire department. But they got the fire out, so it didn't really catch on fire that day either. They'd already had to call the fire department two or three different times, and it was always a false alarm, so I thought, just a false alarm.
Where was it that you were swimming or doing something and Uncle Lloyd got hold
that
of
it? That was up in Trenton.
Was that later on in Trenton?
They did what?
Tell me about that story.
You and Lloyd, where Lloyd was caught on the electrical wire.
That was at Trenton.
And how old were both of you?
We were in high school. I was probably a junior and he was probably ninth grade. He was 2 years.
He was a freshman.
He was a freshman.
Mm-hmm.
And there was up there, right where Lloyd's buried now, there's a canal that went down that went under the railroad. And going under the railroad, there was about a 5 foot diameter pipe that went under the railroad. I don't remember, it was a squash type. And the water in the canal was so 12, 15 feet wide, and that it built up enough header to just shoot under the railroad, and it comes through at such a velocity. It was going so fast to the stream going down below, it would not go, so it would circle back around up toward where it came out from under the railroad. And Lloyd and I and I think one other fellow, maybe it was Marvin South, went down there, and we found a ladder some kids had been playing with. And they get on that ladder and float down the stream, and a couple of days later we went over there. There's Lloyd and I and several other kids. And Lloyd went down there to go under that fence, and we didn't know it had electricity in it, but he touched it. He was standing in water up to his knees. And instead of having a regular electric fence has pulsations on it. Electricity is there for a fraction of a second, then off, so you can always get loose of it, and it won't kill a cow or something like that. But this particular electric fence, they had just taken the wire coming out of a socket and connected one wire into the ground, and the hot wire on the wire going down and back. And Lloyd got on that electric fence and he couldn't get off. And first he yelled to the guy, "Let me show you something." He was trying to get this ladder to put in the water, and he ended up getting a hand on that. And I was on the other side of the stream. The water would come under, let's say the bridge there, the water would come under this way, circle back around like over to Susan, and Lloyd was on the south side, or on the north side, and he couldn't get off, and I yelled, he's on the electric fence, and I yelled, "Grab some clothes and throw it over there." I swam through that current, praying all the way that I could make it, and I went back later on. I never could swim that, but I swam across that stream and went under the wire and got out on the shore, and before the guys had got any clothes over there, there were some burlap bags there, and I threw some of them right on the shore right next to where I could get a hold of Lloyd and wrapped some of them around my hands, and I took a hold of the electric fence and I pushed him. I'd get one hand off and he'd put the other one back on, and finally I guess he sort of passed out and he flipped around and that electric fence fell right on the back of his neck, And when he did that, I took the electric fence with one hand with the burlap bags that I was using, and my other hand, and pushed his head and broke it loose, and he went out into the water, and he recovered when he got into the water out there. And then the only way he could get it back out was to come back under that fence, because the shore was too steep on the other side. Finally, I talked him into coming under that wire, and we got him out. And
that's amazing.
But we found out later that that guy had, I think, two different animals. I think a cow and a pig or something that got against that fence, and it had electrocuted them.
Oh, my word.
And that's just about a quarter of a mile from where Lloyd's buried down there now.
Wow. So you know you were helped by heavenly angels to take care of that.
Well, I was praying that I could get him off of there.
Did they ever make him change the fence so that wouldn't happen to anyone else? Or?
I didn't hear you.
Did they make him change the fence, the wiring on it?
Oh, yeah, we got after him. They went down there and got that change or taken off. Because most fences, people putting up electric fences, put pulsators on so that they, boy, never did want to get near an electric fence again.
I got caught on an electric fence down here and got stuck the same way, but it had the pulsator.
Well, those electric fences, they had current on a second and off a second.
But it felt like I was on it for a half hour. It was so scary.
Huh?
I said they're scary.
Someone told me the fence going across the back of our property is a live wire because of the cows there, because I went to touch it. They're like, don't touch that. That's live wire.
Some of the other things Mom and I did,
uh-huh.
We went swimming out at, what they call it, Laguna? What was the name of the swimming
pool? Oh, I can't remember. It was.
I think it was called Laguna. It was a private swimming pool that we went over there swimming a couple of times. And
in Cache Valley?
One summer we went over to Bear Lake.
That was just before he went into the service.
Well, I really got sunburned.
After he graduated from the college, they were waiting to get their orders to go into the service. And they thought they were all going to go in as second lieutenants. That's what they were supposed to do when they graduated from college. But we decided, we took our car, I think, Ralph got our car, and it was Ralph and Elma and Dad, Donnie, and
I think Darwin Salisbury
and another girl that he was dating, and we went over to Bear Lake, and Dad really got sunburned legs. And
from here it flew up to here, because I had a swimming suit.
And we didn't have stuff to put on in those days, so we kind of all
got sunburned. How come you didn't get sunburned?
I guess they must have got some sunburn, I don't remember. But I know Dad got really sunburned. He's got such white skin.
I got so sunburned that the skin would peel from my knee clear up to where my shorts ended. And I worked on a combine harvesting grain, and I was taking, filling the bags and tying them shut and throwing them off for sliding down. And Winston Benson, a friend of mine who's died now, he was running the combine to raise the cutting bar. And I said, I quit unless I can run that cutting bar, because I couldn't stand to let those bags go against my legs, because it was peeling off all the skin. It was underneath my clothes, but
yes, thank you.
Turn that off.
Okay.
It's supposed to.
It's on standby.
A lot of
okay.
things.
It's okay.
When we were down in Sandy, wiring electric wires and houses would just start. People had their lamps, and he got the job. He read on how to do electric wiring just through taking books on it and studying. And we used things to run the wires in the attic, and you had knobs and tubes. Oh, I got some of those around someplace. It's made of porcelain with a hole in the middle, and when you drill through a tube before, you put one of those through the tube, and then you'd run your wires. It would possibly be best to tell about the story of Dad.
Just start telling it and we'll start recording.
I started to tell him about helping Dad doing electrical wiring down there in Sandy.
Mm-hmm.
But then I need to tell you about where he worked there at Sandy.
Okay.
Your camera doesn't look like it's pointing even right there.
It is.
It's pointing down too much, isn't it?
Mm-mm. No, she's higher than me, so
it's good. Go ahead.
Okay, go ahead, Dad.
Okay. When Dad worked in Sandy, he went down there and he was a third trick man. That means there were three people worked in the railroad station there at Sandy. They covered it, I think, for 24 hours a day. Three different people, each one of them working for 8 hours. And it was also, he did the railroad telegraphy where they took messages, telegraphs, and delivered them in the town. I don't know who delivered them, but it was a railroad station where people catch a train there and go someplace. And there was a truck came in down there. They didn't know who it was. I think they had the name of the people, but they couldn't get the notice to them for them to come pick up their trunk. And it was there for several months. And the other two peoples, and was one of the guy's name, the other name will come to me, but they went through this trunk, and they opened it up, and Dad saw in that trunk a Book of Mormon. And he borrowed the Book of Mormon, because the trunk had been there for several months, no one ever picked it up. And he took the Book of Mormon home to read it. And anyway, I don't know whether he got through reading it or what, but when he came back to put it into the trunk, which was out in the waiting or out in the freight room, it was missing. And they said, oh, the people had finally come and picked up the trunk. And Dad found out and asked him a couple questions where they lived. And they lived out of town, about 3 miles out of town. And Dad took the Book of Mormon that he had borrowed and walked out there to return it to the people. And he explained to him that no one had picked it up there, and that he had taken this book out and had read it, and he was returning it to him. And they thanked him for doing that. And then these other two fellows and Dad's, and they were both what Dad called Jack Mormons, they accused him of stealing some silverware that was in this trunk. And they wanted, and it was really them that stole it. Or at least they knew some who had taken it. And then they called up these people and asked them if there had been anything missing. And they couldn't get the people to say anything was missing because they surmised that they would be blaming Dad for stealing it. And yet they knew darn good and well he had not done it. Why would he return a book that he had taken out of there, Book of Mormon? So anyway, they went ahead and reported this stuff being stolen. Dad got
who's they? Who reported it?
The two people.
The men. The Jack Mormons?
Yeah.
Okay.
People. The other name will come to me. One of them named Peebles and McDonald or something like that.
So the people that owned the trunk didn't report it still?
No, they didn't report it. They found out that it was there. They finally found out that they'd never picked it up, or maybe they're supposed to pick it up in Salt Lake or someplace. Anyway, they got it back. But these two other operators there insinuated that Dad had done it. They got Dad fired. And then Dad was out of work there for a while, and maybe that might have been the time that he took up wiring houses for until he could get back on. But he went to Salt Lake to the general manager there and explained the situation. And finally, they had a hearing on it and claimed that he had stolen it. These people says, no, they know he didn't steal it because of...
They testified for him.
They testified for him, and Dad got his job back. He didn't want to work back with those two guys that had blamed him for that. But at that time, he got a job working at what they call the towers up there in Salt Lake City, where they direct the trains as they come in on different tracks, and they switch them from one track to the other, and they keep track of all the cars from where they're going. He was working in the tower there at Salt Lake City. But that was one experience that he had that turned him against what was going on with people who were supposed to be Mormons. But he, I think, having read the Book of Mormon, I think he was converted partly. And then from there, he worked at a lot of different places. He worked out in Aberdeen, and he worked up at Orchard, and he worked at... place just north of Ogden there, kind of thing. where that hot springs over there is.
Is that Saratoga? No. Yeah. Oh, no.
Up there in
Honeyville.
Near where John was killed.
Honeyville, isn't that Honeyville?
Honeyville. He worked there. And
I didn't know he worked there.
But when we moved to Iona, I don't think he worked in the church there. I remember going to sacrament meeting one time in Iona. And I remember the guy's name that gave the talk, and his name was Stosich. He was from Germany, and I think I remember he was talking about the beautiful bed flowers. He didn't call them flower beds around the church.
The beautiful bed flowers.
But anyway, there's a lot of. And then while I was at Iona, they got me a job of delivering papers. I remember in 1935, it went down 35 degrees below zero. 35 or 36 or 37 along there when I was delivering papers.
How old were you?
I was probably in the eighth grade then.
Did you make trips over to Boise to see your... Did you go to Boise much to see your grandparents?
Every summer we'd... I'll go over to Boise and spend a couple of weeks with Grandpa and Grandma Jones.
Tell us about their place.
Mother would go over there and we'd go over there with her, maybe Lloyd and I. And
what do you remember about their place in Boise?
Oh, Grandpa had a bird dog, Ari Setter, and he lived out there on Eustick Road. And I don't know where his house was, and he had grapevines and Ari were going over the... And he had a couple of cows. They milked the cows and sold milk. And
do you remember chicken coops?
Go out hunting when he'd take his bird dogs down there on the Boise River, train them to flush the birds out when they take them, and he'd go hunting. And
so he was good with training his dogs.
We went a lot with them, and I remember that they had a garden there, and that's where Aunt Mary was married, in that house.
Well, that's how it says that. That's how that your grandpa met your grandma, was because he had an Irish setter that kept running away, and she found it.
And so, who?
That's how your grandpa.
Why? Grandpa Jones? Or he met who?
That's how he met Maddie, because he had an Irish setter and it kept getting away, and she caught it and liked it, and that's how they ended up meeting, I think.
Well, I don't think that's the situation, because he lived in Park City first.
No.
No, but this was when...
No, he didn't live in Park City before
Crete.
They married.
They got married over in Crete, Colorado.
Yeah.
They
but
were
that's
married
where he
in
had
Crete.
That's where you went, Wina.
Yes.
But that's the story, is that they met because he had this dog.
I thought he lived at the boarding house that her mother ran.
Yeah.
I don't remember that story, but... My dad graduated from Tyler Business College, and he got him a job up at Park City as a beginner railroad telegrapher in training, and he went up there, and mother and her girlfriends used to come by to see the young railroad telegrapher, which was dad there, and that's where dad met mother.
Met my mother.
But what do you remember about, what else do you remember about Morgan Jones and Maddie Jones, your grandma and Grandpa Jones?
Well, that's out of chronological order, but...
No, you were just talking about visiting them in the summers when you lived in Iona.
Well, that's after when we were out at Iona.
Yeah.
We used to go up to Boise, even when we were in Salt Lake. We could get passes, and I know a lot of times they'd put Lloyd and I on the train, and we'd go up by ourselves from Salt Lake to Boise.
Starting at what age, do you think?
And they'd come up to the... They'd call and let them know, and we'd just hit the train.
Probably age six.
How young were you when you started making those trips back and forth?
Well, the first time we went alone, I think I was 8 years old. About that.
What do you remember about your grandma, particularly?
My Grandma Jones?
Mm-hmm.
She was a good cook, and she used to can a lot of stuff. And I remember my Aunt Mary, she was only, I don't remember how many years younger she was than mother.
About eight.
Huh?
6 or 8 years younger.
Mm-hmm.
So did your Grandpa Jones have a horse? Did he have horses? Or?
Yeah, he had a horse at a time or two. But...
did your grandma sew or quilt or anything that you remember?
My grandmother, she only did painting.
Yeah, she was the artist. She was
and
the one.
We might have one of her paintings. Have you got it now, Mary?
I have one.
I think that's what my mom had. Then they used to store them in the chicken house out there. She painted up at night.
Yeah, it's got a hole in it.
Huh?
It's got a hole in the canvas.
But she did quite a bit of painting. And I think her and Mary had most of them. Her kids have got the paintings.
So tell us about the railroad depot in Iona, when you lived in the railroad depot.
When we were living in Salt Lake, and Dad, I think, was working out at the towers where I mentioned,
uh-huh.
He bid in jobs. And the way you got a job, the person that had the most seniority, if you wanted a job, anybody that wanted a job, they'd send the bulletin out that this job was available, and then anybody that was interested in it would send in their resume, which would amount to no more than where they'd worked and how long they'd worked for the railroad. The person that worked the longest with the railroad and had certain minimum qualifications, and since he had served as an express agent and as a railroad telegrapher, he ended up getting a job up at Iona. And we were going to go up there for about three months. And we had a nice home in Salt Lake, bathtub, kitchen sink, a spring. We had our own spring right in our yard there.
Wow.
Artesian well. In other words, they drilled the well, and there was the groundwater was under pressure, and it would rise right up, and it would shoot up into the house. But then we had a little basin out there with a pump on it that could pump the water into the house.
And then you had the
outhouse. I think later on we actually ended up getting on the city water, but we always had that well out there where we used to have fish in it. But we had a house there that had, I think, three bedrooms in it. I don't remember whether Dad built the basement room down there, but we moved there and just locked up that house.
Is it still there, the home in Sandy?
Yes, it's still there.
Is that the one where he dug the basement?
754 Parker's no. Lane.
Oh, okay.
That's the address.
Is that the Salt Lake one?
Is that the one where he dug out the basement for it?
No.
That's Kaysville.
No, I think the one we really dug out of the basement was right there at Kaysville.
Yeah.
I watched him dig it out.
But anyway, we moved up to Iona, and it was in the summertime. Dad got the job up there, and I started the 7th grade, and Lloyd started the 5th grade in Iona. And in my 7th grade, it was the 7th and 8th grade taught in the same class by one teacher. All 8 hours a day, or how many hours you're there?
6.
And Truman Rigby was the teacher there, and he used to like to read Zane Grey's books. I think I heard any of his books, and he'd start sometimes reading a book, and he wouldn't quit reading it until 3 o'clock, times for school to let out quite often.
So that's why Max Keller liked Zane Grey. He started collecting those books, and he went to school at Iona.
A couple of them I've run across, but.
So what was the railroad like? What was your house like inside? I mean,
Iona?
Yeah.
Out at Iona, we didn't have a house.
So you lived in the depot. Did you have a kitchen?
In the depot, there was one room. I guess you'd call it a bedroom. And it was maybe about the size of our bedroom upstairs, my own bedroom now. And then we had a kitchen. The kitchen was very small. It was about 8 feet by 12, 15 feet long, and it had a stove in there, what we call a pot belly stove, and they had a floor mat underneath of it that had metal on it, so if the coals came out of and landed on it, it would metal and it wouldn't catch the floor on fire. And then there was another, I guess that was the only, there was only one stove in that whole building, and it was in the kitchen, and it was open between the kitchen and the office for the railroad office. Then there was a window where people would come in to buy their tickets and to pay their bills. And then there was a little waiting room. That little waiting room was about, from here, from the lamp to the wall there and from my knee to the wall, just a room. It had enough room for a single bed, a cot, that folded up to that width. And at night, we would unfold that, and Lloyd and I slept out there in the waiting room. There was no heat out there at all. And it got pretty cold, too. And we would heat bricks and wrap those bricks in towels and put them in the foot of our bed to keep our feet warm.
Did the trains come by at night?
No, the trains came by all day long, and it kept us awake at first, but they could... The trains were as close as from here to, or closer than from here to that fence out back. There was about 20 feet between the building and the railroad track. But it got so that when the trains come through, it wouldn't even wake us up.
What age were you when you went to visit your grandparents in Alabama? Was that when you were living in Iona or younger?
1935.
I think there when the first time we went, I think I was, we were living in Salt Lake, maybe even Sandy.
So tell us about your trip to Alabama.
I think I bumped across the time I went back there. It might have been when I was in the second grade, or maybe when I was in the third grade and Lloyd was in the first grade. And we went down to Alabama and mother went.
With your
dad never went. We went down there on the train.
Just with your mother? That's surprising.
And Lloyd and I went down there. And when we went down there, there was Floyd, and Roland, and I guess those two brothers were home then at that time, and Jesse. Jesse might have been dead by that, I don't remember. I think dead. Dad had a brother, Jesse, that had two sons, Hora and... And I think when he got killed, she remarried and married another fellow, and then she had another son there. They lived over in, I think, over in Weezer, Idaho. We went over there several times to visit them.
Why don't you tell them all about Alabama?
Well, she directed me. In Alabama, I remember we went out. They had a horse down there, one horse. Kids took a couple kids on horse and one and a half walk, and we went out in the woods there, and we learned to...
I'm out of battery. Are you guys okay?
I'm fine.
Did you turn that off?
Battery's gone, dude.
You're fine. I'm still filming.
Anyway, we went out there, and we went hunting for turtles. We brought some turtles home. We got little turtles that big, and one of them, I think we got about that big. I remember I had one of them bite me on the toe when we were wading out in the water there, and they had the... moccasin snakes down there, poisonous snake. We didn't end up getting any of those, but I remember we got lost out there because there was a squirrel that went up around the trees, and we walked around the tree watching the tree squirrel go up the tree, and we were out in the forest, and we couldn't remember which way we came in there.
Was that you and Floyd and Lloyd?
Huh?
Was it all three of you?
Well, it was Lloyd, and I think it was Lloyd and I and Floyd and his brother.
Rollin.
Anyway, and all I remember about my grandfather Cooley is...
You mean grandfather
Benton?
My grandfather Benton. He drank a lot, and he also run a, what do you call him?
Whiskey still.
During the Prohibition days, they had manufactured bootleg whiskey.
I knew that his son did, that one of the boys did, but I didn't know your grandpa did too, huh?
So you remember him drinking?
I remember seeing them a couple of times, but they lived in a real poor house, and they used to have chickens running all around the yard.
Did you stay at the house with them, or did you stay in? Did you stay at their house?
Yes.
Okay, so tell about their house again, what you remember.
Did you just sleep on the floor there?
I don't remember. It didn't matter where I slept. I can't remember.
What about your grandma?
We probably slept out on the porch. Oh, there's a story that happened down there, though, that I didn't see it, but Floyd told about. What you nudging me for?
The story about the pig?
Oh.
About the what?
Well, tell us what you remember.
No, go ahead and let him finish the story.
Okay.
What were you saying?
Nothing.
Okay. Well, they had a bear get in trying to kill their pig. And you got that recorded by the way.
Yeah, I do. I have the recording of Floyd telling this.
More accurate story of what Floyd told you.
That was actually his grandpa.
Huh?
That was a story about his grandpa.
It was a story about
Floyd's
his grandmother.
Grandpa.
Grandma and grandpa. Yeah.
What do you remember about your grandma, Benton?
Well, I remember that one of the few pictures that I got is one that I took with a little box camera.
On your trip when you went down there in about 35, when you were 14?
I had a little box camera and I took some pictures.
So you made another trip to Alabama?
I think we went down there about 3 times.
Well, about the time you went out with Floyd on the horse.
Well, the time we went out with Floyd on the horse, that's when we sort of got mixed up in which way to go out of there. But the horse ate our own lunch, we remember that.
That's funny.
We caught some little turtles we got home with us.
Was their house like a log cabin, or was it a frame house? Do you remember?
It was an old frame house. I don't remember even having any paint on it.
Was it quite a ways out in the woods by itself?
In the woods.
And did he farm too? Were they quite...
I don't know what he really did.
I thought...
For a while, Floyd said he cut up trees for railroad ties and sold them.
Yeah. Did you know Jordan's down there right now in Alabama? Just to the west of Shelby County, fighting wildfires.
Shelby County is where Dad was born, down there in Shelby County.
Did you travel by train to go visit him?
Yes. Free ticket.
And when you went, the time you took the pictures, did you go by yourself or did Lloyd go with you then too?
No, the time I went down there once by myself, but the times I went down there, I went down there with Mother, I think about 3 times.
Okay.
It was before Juanita was born. Juanita went down there several times with Mother and Dad.
But you never went down there?
I never did go down to Alabama with my dad.
That's what I was just going to ask. Okay.
That's interesting.
Tell me about your trip back to New York City.
Well, when we lived out at Iona, I went to New York twice. I went with the Boy Scouts when I was 12 years old. Dad got a ticket for me, and they were going to go back to the World's Jamboree, and that was in 1935 or 36 there. And because of the polio epidemic that broke out there, they canceled the World Jamboree. But Teton Peace Council decided to still make the trip, and we went back on the train, left Idaho Falls, and went back through Palmar. And I remember before we got there, the train ran into a thrash machine. And we went back, that delayed us for a while, and then we stopped at a place called Palmyra. And there they took a tour, most of them were LDS, I guess, and we all went down to Joe Smith's house and went through the house there, and then went out to the Sacred Grove, which is about a quarter of a mile. Any of you been there?
Yes, I have.
About a quarter of a mile. You say you've been there, Wanda?
Yes.
It's about a quarter of a mile directly to the west of Joe Smith's house. His house was on the east side of the road, and right across this little almost one-lane road out in the field about 1,000 feet or so. It was just a plowed field, or they'd already cut off the trees. Then the Sacred Grove was there, and you went in the grove there 200 or 300 feet, and that's the place where Joseph saw Jesus and God the Father there.
Did they have guides there that told you about it?
Yeah, they had guides that went out there with us and told us the story.
And what was your impression?
I believed it.
Because I remember you telling that
and then
to
we
us
went
more,
up,
yeah.
I can't remember. I think we went up to the Hill Cumorah, but you don't know what place it was that they dug up the tray and plates there.
Did Lloyd go to these places with you?
No.
Just you?
Lloyd didn't want... Now, I was a Boy Scout then. He wasn't old enough to go when I went with the Scouts to there. But then from Palmyra, we caught the train there. We stopped it. On the way, we stopped in Chicago and went to the Hayden Planetarium in Chicago, and we went to the place that manufactured shredded wheat, and they served shredded wheat with bananas on it, and I always liked that.
That's where he started loving bananas on his cereal.
Well, I learned how to upset a glass of milk. I remember I upset my glass of milk there on the table, and I was... But anyway, we went from there, and we went to this planetarium, and then we went on up to Upper New York, up to Albany. And at Albany, we caught a ferry boat and went down the Hudson River into New York City.
Did you know that your great-great-grandfather, August Gerstenberg, possibly took that route because he applied for naturalization there in Buffalo, New York?
Well, you researched that. I didn't know.
So, but when you made the trip, you probably had no idea that that's where you're...
Anyway, that was basically the trip we made, and then stopped a few places on the way back. But then when I was... I guess it's when I graduated from high school, wasn't it?
Mm-hmm.
When I graduated from high school, Lloyd and I each had about $35 a piece saved up from hoeing beets and thinning beets. And Lloyd didn't want to go with me. He wanted to stay home buying a bike. So he ordered him a Sears Nova, a fancy bike. And I took my $35 and got my tickets and went back all by myself to New York City.
That's pretty amazing.
There was a World Fair on.
I thought we had a picture of both you and Lloyd.
Lloyd didn't go.
Okay.
There was a World's Fair on in New York City at that time.
Is that why you wanted to go back?
There was a World's Fair at that time.
Is that why you went back, is for the World's Fair?
Yes,
And you went all by yourself?
Yes.
Tell about your phone call. Did you call your parents?
Tell
them
about some of your experiences.
Well, one thing was interesting. It cost about $7. I only took off of here with $35, and I was going to go all the way to New York City and to the World's Fair for 3 days and down to Alabama. And I had a total of $35 plus my air ticket. So I stopped and go to a grocery store and grab a loaf of bread and some Vienna sausage or something to eat with it. And I didn't use much money to get food. When I got in New York City, I spent a large sum, though, for 2 nights a hotel room. I think I paid $4 a night for 2 nights there in New York City, and I don't know, $4 or $5 to get into the fair. But anyway, when I got back from my trip,
I only
had about $10 left out of the $35.
But you didn't tell them about what happened at the World's Fair.
Oh, at the World's Fair, they were demonstrating long-distance telephone calls, showing, and they had a big board that was showing the lights flashing, how they made connection between this line. A phone line would be called here, they'd send you to Chicago, and then from Chicago to Omaha, and then from Omaha to Salt Lake, from Salt Lake to Boise. And you had a chance of winning it. So you wrote down your number, you picked out a ball, and they put this ping pong ball in there, and they're flopping around, they draw them out. And I won the first time it went around, and I got a ticket, and I called my mother and dad on the phone, talked to them, free charge. The only thing was that people could all listen in to how they were making the connections. They could hear everything you said, and I thought, oh, that was good. So I got to talk to mother and dad and tell them how I was doing, and I said, I'll try that again. Next time, I got another winner. And so I took my call and called my Aunt Mary in Boise. And I really enjoyed the World Fair. I got to go through exhibits where they had some world-famous artists there.
Well, we have pictures of it, and you're in some of them. Did you just ask people to take your picture then?
Oh, yeah, I had a little box camera, too, by me. I wasn't bashful. But...
I must have gotten it from him.
But it was quite fun.
And you were how old?
18.
Oh, I was 18 years old.
Oh.
Not quite, I could turn 18 in June after I graduated.
So how did your mother feel about you making that trip by yourself?
She knew I was experienced traveling alone. I started traveling alone when I was 8. And I didn't have a Pullman to sleep in. I just had a chair and a pillow that they furnished. And
then he took the train to Alabama to see his grandfather.
Yeah, after we were through with the fair, I caught a train and went to Alabama.
And that when you took that picture? That's where you took the pictures of Grandma.
It could have been.
Yeah.
So they were both still alive, but by that time, both your Grandma and Grandpa Jones had passed away, right?
I think so, yeah.
Do you remember much about when they died or going to their funeral?
Yeah,
or?
They were around 58 or 60 apiece. I got there.
Wow, that's young. How did they die?
I don't know what they died from. I think Dad and Grandpa they didn't go to doctors, so you don't really know what happened. Mm-hmm. Couldn't afford it. I remember going to Mary Moore's wedding. It was, she was married right there in Grandma Jones's house. They used to put up their Christmas tree in one room and left it there all summer long and redecorated some the next year.
Was it a real tree? Didn't the needles all fall off? Or?
Oh, I don't remember those details.
So you didn't ever tell us what you remember of Grandma Benton, your grandmother Benton.
I don't remember very much about her.
Because she died fairly young, too.
She was real gracious to us and real happy her grandsons had come down to see her.
Did you know very many of your cousins on either side of the family?
Yes, when we moved out to Salt Lake, Dad's sister Annie, her husband got killed right there. Someone murdered him. And Dad invited her to come out to Salt Lake to see if she could get a job there. And she had two daughters. And
is Annie the one who ended up joining the church? Which sister of your dad's ended up joining?
Mildred, I think. Which one was it was baptized? We were looking up for genealogy. I think it was Mildred. Oh.
And how did she get baptized? How did she hear about the church?
I don't know anything about it. And then the fact that she, we know that, looking on the internet and through the church record.
Well, a lot of the work has been done in the Birmingham Temple on the Benton lines, as I've done research.
So. That's interesting. So now tell us about some of the stories that they wanted on camera about the magpies.
Well, I told you, said you already had
it. But, yeah, they wanted it again on there.
Lloyd and I became real good shots with a .22. We could set a .22 MP2, .22 cartridge out on the fence, and we could knock them off about 30 feet away. I think we just had one .22 rifle between us. And you got paid 4 cents for every adult magpie you killed. You took their head and saved that.
Who paid you? Who was doing this?
The county. Bottom County had a bounty on them. They paid you 4 cents for each adult magpie you brought in, and every baby magpie you got 2 cents, and every egg you brought in you got 1 cent. So we played smart. We'd wait until the eggs had hatched at least before we went after the birds. But we killed more magpies, the two of us, than anybody else in Bonneville County. We turned them in, and that day we won, that year we won our .22 rifle. And the next year was when we moved, the summer we moved from Trenton, or from Oahiona to Trenton. And we had enough points saved up, and what we would do, Dad got us some formaldehyde, and so they wouldn't stink, you know, like they, we'd put the heads of the adults and the baby chickens in there. We'd just count them and put them in there. They'd take our word on how many was there, but we kept a tab of it. And the next year we had enough that we didn't think we could win the prize all. We didn't have quite as many as we won the first prize before, but Hubert Rockwood, who runs a barge out there in Iona now, he was close friend of mine, and I asked him if he wanted to pay us the penny a piece that we got, what money we had coming, and so we could get our money out of it. And he did that, and he turned in our eggs and heads, and if he had turned ours in, or if we had turned ours in before we left, we would have won first prize. But instead, he won first prize by putting his with it, and he won a new bicycle.
So tell us about after you moved from Iona to Trenton and then making your trip back. Where did you make your trip back to make your bicycle, to go on a bicycle scout?
We rode bicycles from Trenton to Idaho Falls.
You were riding your bicycles to go on a 25-mile hike with the bicycle hike, weren't you, with the scouts out here?
I don't think it's quite 25 miles. It's from Iona up to Bone.
Oh, okay. But that's what you rode your bicycle, all those miles. To go on another bicycle ride with the scouts.
And did you just sleep out? Did it take you one day? How long did it take you to ride from Trenton?
We made We made it from Trenton to Pocatello by 4 o'clock. We went to the grocery store and bought a loaf of bread and some...
What time did you leave?
Hamburger. We left about 4 or 5 o'clock in the morning. And we were tired after 12 hours of riding a bike. And so we...
Was it dirt roads?
Well, some of it was highway. They were building the concrete highway down there from Income up to Pocatello, so part of it was pavement, a good share of it was pavement, but some of it was concrete. But we slept overnight, and we didn't have sleeping bags, we just had a blanket apiece, and rolled it up as our bedroll, and laid the blanket on the ground, and another blanket, or half the blanket, over us, and next morning we got up at daylight, and we got to Idaho Falls, we got to Alta Iona by 10 o'clock in the morning from Pocatello. And then that time we met, I think, to whatever time it was that they left, we were there on time. And we went with them up the phone. And then when we came back, we decided not to ride back.
So did you put your bikes on the train?
We put bikes on the train. And the reason we didn't do that coming up is because there was no trains made any connections. But going back, they stopped right at Trenton, and we got our bikes off at Trenton. And
wow.
The train stopped for us and let us off. And
okay. Dad, can I ask you a question? This is something I really want you to just think about. Carl has done a program with some people, and it's a question they ask them as they're sometimes meeting with their children and having a whole group discussion, kind of like we've been doing. But they'll ask them the question of, if you were to have a few minutes to pass on a legacy to your grandchildren, what would you want to tell them? So just think about that for a minute, but if there were...
I think more than a minute, I thought we'd tell them all that we knew now.
No, a legacy. What would be your advice to your grandchildren?
Well, they had a good lesson in priesthood meeting today. Integrity.
And we know from watching your life that integrity... Can you think of an experience in your life where that made a difference in your life?
Well, we were always taught to be honest. In fact, Dad always trusted us kids, and I think he tried to teach us that way. Even though he was handling money for the railroad, he would let us take the railroad money from the railroad to the bank for him. So
he trusted you.
The fact that he trusted us.
And I can tell you that the bank in Kaysville trusted Grandpa enough that he was willing to loan his son's money. He loaned Dad and Lloyd's money to start the business up here, and he loaned some, I think, to Paul. They said that Grandpa Benton was an honest man. And
when we came up here to buy a new car, I called up the bank, Henry Blood there at Kaysville, and told him I needed 1,800 borrowed money to buy a new Plymouth. That's all it cost him, 18. And how'd it go about? He said, I think we were already banking there. We had a bank account there. And he said, you run out the check and I'll cover it for you, and I'll send you the papers to sign after I get the bill.
But didn't you borrow $10,000 same way, just by calling?
Oh, yeah. Several times I borrowed a large amount of money. I don't think it was over at $10,000, but I just call them up and they tell them, go ahead and write out the check, and they cover it.
So in your life, from your dad or from anyone, as you were working on your business or anything, what was the best advice you ever received?
Just to be honest.
Barbara, did you have any questions you wanted to ask Mom and Dad or Dad?
What would you tell your grandkids about the church? And how you feel about it?
Well, they know how I feel about it.
Your grandkids.
Oh, my grandkids?
Mm-hmm.
I guess I should have more communication with them, but bear my testimony to them that I know it's the truth.
Tell them about when you were called to be bishop. What happened before you were called to be bishop?
What happened before?
Mm-hmm.
lots of things.
You told me once, though, that you had a premonition before they came to ask you.
Oh, right before, I just had, I got the feeling, though, I knew that they were going to reorganize the stake and possibly form a new ward and all that. I didn't really think about it too much, but I was acting as the assistant stake clerk. And a general authority was up. I don't remember whether it was Brother Benson or not was up, but whoever the authority was, they said they wanted to meet with all of the High Council. And
was that Ezra Taft?
I said I'm not sure which one it was. But they wanted to meet with all of them, and I said, well, I was going to be out of town. I wouldn't be available. I was leaving to take my kids to the
BYU
education meeting. And I just kept getting the feeling, I didn't say it to anyone, but I got a feeling they're going to call you as a bishop. How could they do that when they got all the High Council and all the others? And Lloyd was in the house. He came over here and went in the kitchen and looked out the window and he said, it looks like your whole church is coming to see you. Al Johnson and
Milton Romerl,
I think, and President Ahlstrom. And so Lloyd said, you better get out of here. So he left and they came in right here in this room.
I thought it wasn't President Ahlstrom. I thought that it was the state president.
Okay.
Well, Hal Johnson was.
Well, maybe it was. Oh, no, I guess it was. He was a counselor to Paul Brzee.
It was Paul Brzee that came.
It was the state president.
And it was Hal.
Johnson.
Huh?
Hal Johnson.
And
Milt Romerl.
And President Romerl. And they came in and asked if I would be.
President Brzee.
And I said, well, I'd have to talk a little with my wife, so we stepped out. I don't remember where I went over to the bedroom and talked to the horn. Asked her how she felt about it.
Well, I think I went down there with him, but we were all packed up, ready to go down to BYU.
I know, he was with me, and Dorothy had a friend. And
everybody kept saying, why aren't we going? And Dad said, they had called and said they were coming. But before that, he'd had this premonition.
I think it was the day before that I got that feeling.
And so they called up and wanted to come over to talk to him. And we were together. We went down in the TV room there and talked to them and told your kids not to come down. And
I think they were already out in the car.
It's a long wait.
Susan, where were you?
Out in the car.
So did you find it quite a challenge being bishop and having a young family and running a business? I mean, that was a lot to juggle at one time.
I didn't even once worry about that. All the time I was bishop, I had more time than I did when I wasn't.
That's interesting. I think the Lord does that.
But I've told you this story before when they said, I said we'd talked it over and I'd be willing to accept the calling. And then I think it was Hal Johnson said, but you'll have to cancel your trip. I said, no. I says, I can name several people in the ward I think would be a better bishop than me. And I've always been taught that families come first and the kids are all ready to go to Utah. We're going to drop off the younger ones to mothers and Grandma Benton was going to take care of them. And then I think Brother
Rosine
said, oh, I think that'd be all right. Then one of them spoke up and said, but you'll have to be back Sunday. I said, no, I won't be back Sunday because we're going on the vacation and we'll be back.
It went over Sunday until the middle of the next week.
Anyway, then on the way down, I was supposed to stop and talk to George Q. Morris.
We ended up talking to him.
We couldn't talk because we had car trouble. We had a flat tire. So. So I had to go to the phone and call down there and said I couldn't meet the appointment at his office. And one, no. He said, well, I asked him where he'd be later when I could do it. He said, well, he was speaking that night down at, he'd be down the commencement of BYU graduation. Where were we finding him? He said, well, I'll be right on the pulpit, on the stage. And so after the meeting was over, well, I went up on the stage there and
we were actually out on the basketball court. There were people all the way around it. We had a really good interview. Then we went up to his office.
But anyway, they were
later, funny. Just before we came home.
Anyway,
but Dad had to call in and tell him who he wanted for counselors. So the counselors got put in before he did.
They were set apart as counselors to Bishop Benton, who didn't exist.
That's interesting.
And they said, well, what do we do about the ward? And he said, just tell them to go wherever they've been going until we start the ward the week afterwards.
Let them go back and tell the people in their present ward goodbye. And they accepted that.
Was that the same time that Dorothy broke her nose or another?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay.
Dorothy broke her nose?
Yeah, we were down at BYU Education Week and was she jumping
she
on a trampoline?
She was on the trampoline and they had, remember, they wired you up or something and somehow she managed to
hit the edge or something.
Hit the edge and broke her nose and they sent her to somebody there and they said that it was, they could push it and straighten it and...
They did a poor job.
Anyway, when we got home, went in to see Reem Jones, and he said it was really badly broken. We had to put her in the hospital and have it fixed.
I didn't know that. Yeah.
Oh, and she was supposed to go to, that was when they had the dance festivals going on, and she had paid the money and was supposed to go to the dance festival. And we called up and said that, you know, we'd had this problem with the nose breaking and weren't going to be able to get home in time to for her to ride back down on the bus with him and stuff, but she could meet him down there. And the stake young women's president said, well, anybody, oh, she was supposed to have brought her money over and paid it before we went and we forgot. She forgot in all of the excitement. And they said, since she didn't pay her money, we put somebody else in her place. We found out later they didn't. We'd paid part of the money or something like that. I don't remember. But
I danced in a lot of those dance festivals, and I might have done it right
then,
too.
That's immaterial.
Anyway, they wouldn't let her stay and dance. And then they didn't want to give us back the money that she had paid previously. And... So I talked to President Jones about it. He was the state president. And he said, that's ridiculous. They made the decision not to let her stay. Oh, I guess that she paid money for a hotel or something, you know, that they were going to stay in. And she still owed a little bit more or something. So he insisted that they pay her back the money. He said, they made the decision. You didn't.
Go ahead.
Oh, this is completely away from that, so if you want to still...
Oh, no, I just...
I wanted to ask you, Dad, when your first recollection was, when you were growing up and in Kaysville and any of those places, did you ever attend the LDS Church on a regular basis or even go to it? Or was it only when you went to college? How did you get involved besides... You said you had to memorize the...
I never went regularly until I got in college.
Did you?
I went quite often.
So... And didn't you say when you were attending in college that they came up and asked you to administer to the sacrament or something?
No, that was when I went into the service.
Was that in the service? Tell that story.
Well, they used to have sacrament reading for the LDS people, and they designated a place to have it, and all the LDS people to go to this chapel or room in the site.
And was this before you were married?
Huh?
Is this before you were married?
Yes.
Yeah, well, I was back there going to OCS.
Okay.
And they were dragging me up there to the stand and wanted me to minister the sacrament. And I said, no, I'm not going to minister the sacrament. They said, oh, yes, you are. I said, I thought you had to be a member of the church and you had to have the priesthood before you could minister the sacrament. You do. And I said, you know, I'm not even a member of the LDS church. So I got out of it.
But you'd been attending so regularly that they thought you were.
Yes.
So did you have a testimony at this time? Or not really? What made you go
regularly? Oh, I think I actually had a testimony that I knew the gospel was true when I went out to the Sacred Grove when I was a Boy Scout.
And that remained with you then since then?
Yeah, but I had a lot of cases where I didn't think the Latter-day Saints were living up to their standards.
Did you and your family attend church ever, as a family?
Well, when we were in Kaysville, Dad went to priesthood meeting all the time.
No, but I mean other churches, when you were little.
Oh, yes, I went to Bible for going to the Methodist church for so many months without missing a Sunday.
And did you all attend together as a family?
Mother used to say I was the only child of hers that had been baptized, and I'd been baptized twice. Once in the Methodist church and once in the...
So Mina asked, did you and Grandpa and Grandma, Lloyd, did you all attend like the Methodist church together or just you, or how did that happen?
Lloyd and I used to go. We'd walk to church there in Salt Lake City.
But Grandma didn't go? It was just the two of you? What made you go? Friends?
Well, they asked us to go. Mother and Dad wanted us to go.
But they didn't go with you.
And then they did start attending in Kaysville.
To Kaysville. That's after...
How many years were you there before they...
But you were in college when you moved to Kaysville.
I was in college when I went to Kaysville. Dad was always civic-minded. He helped in the Boy Scouts and the membership drives. And when they were remodeling the church, he was an electrician. He went down and helped him do wiring. I don't know how many hundred hours he put in working on the church all the time he had off. And he worked out. He was a fundraiser for the Boy Scouts in the Kaysville ward there. And
so it's through the Boy Scouts, basically, that he got involved with the church doing things there?
I think so.
But they started going to church quite
regularly.
He'd
read the Book of Mormon. He believed it.
When he had borrowed it out of that trunk.
Mm-hmm. And they went to church. They went to church almost all the time.
Grandma was the
Mother
Relief
served
Society.
As the secretary in the Young Women's Organization for several years.
Was it Young Women's or Relief Society?
Huh?
It was Young Women's, huh?
Uh-huh.
And she was a visiting teacher for a long time, too, without being a member, right?
Who?
Grandma. Didn't she do visiting teaching, too?
I don't know if she did that.
But I knew she was the secretary, but I thought it was
Relief Society. But I know they would call her for information. Maybe that was in Relief Society. But they went to Sunday school and sacrament meeting.
Well, they had things that were...
Was that because Juanita was in Young Women's?
I don't know, but... She told Daniel when he was going to go back to
Baltimore
to dental school that it would be a good idea for him to join the church before he went.
Oh, so he wasn't a member.
So he could marry a Latter-day Saint girl.
Well, she just thought it would be a good idea for him to
have friends back there.
A place to go to when he got back there. And
wow.
So she had him join the church, didn't he?
Yes, she did.
How old was Juanita when she joined the church?
Huh?
How old was Juanita?
Did she join at age 8?
I think she joined my class. She was around 8 years old or so.
That's what I was thinking.
And John Eldon joined the church and went on a mission to Hawaii.
They sent him on a mission and they weren't members.
So when you were in Logan backing up again and member of the fraternity there. Did you go every Sunday to the LDS church then and participate that way in college?
Yes, because they held, like I told you, they held church up at the Institute, so
I went
quite a lot. And that's where I went to church too.
So nobody in all that time ever approached you on receiving the missionaries or being baptized or why?
I had a roommate that was the Elders' Quorum president. Ted Bernheisel, who's now an MD radiologist specialist in Salt Lake City. And he was my roommate, and I don't know who invited the missionaries to come over, but two or three of us in the room, and And missionaries asked Ted to bear his testimony. He says, I don't realize I have a testimony. He was the elders quorum president. So that helps convert me, didn't it? Phil Horn was a roommate of mine. He ended up being a bishop back in Baltimore. And I remember that I'd been taught by my dad and mother to say my prayers. I always used to say my prayers just laying in bed, but he was the one that set an example to kneel down the bed and say his prayers.
And so that's when you first started doing it, is that after watching him?
No, I started then, but that's who convinced me of. That's what I should be doing.
Did you have any great experiences as a bishop?
Huh?
Any experiences you remember that were special as a bishop?
Lots of them. A lot of them were confidential, too.
Okay.
Greg just had a record that came into our ward.
Huh?
Greg is the high priest group leader, and they got a membership record of somebody into the ward we're in now, and you ordained him to be an elder, because your name was on the record. He showed me it on the...
That's neat.
The you membership.
Remember who it was? Kurt Krupp? No?
No, no. This is somebody who's not... I don't know if they're active anymore. It's an older gentleman. I'd have to ask Greg his name.
Well, I'm almost out of time on the...
I just wanted to ask him one last question. When you were in Hawaii, is that when you met Marion...
Duff Hanks?
Yeah.
Marion D.
Hanks. And is that, did you have
you
a special that. Spiritual experience through him?
Not particularly, other than the fact that I knew him quite well and went to church. First time I went to church over there, and I went into second meeting, and in the row I was sitting in, there was nobody had any shoes on. I thought, am I supposed to take my shoes off in this church here? In Hawaii, they have a policy that you take your shoes off and go to people's houses. So you don't track mud and dirt in. But they were just kids that couldn't afford shoes. And I took them, one time I took one of my army associates in the church with me, and it was on, they're passing the sacrament, and when they passed the sacrament tray around, he stuck a silver dollar on the sacrament tray. And it came to me, I took the dollar off and took my sacrament and gave him back his dollar and explained it to him.
And you were a member of the church at this time.
Yes. You know how I was interviewed to become an elder? I had a special, special person go in and interview for me. One went in and interviewed for my...
I don't know how could they ordained him an elder exactly. Our records were in Newton, and I don't remember even being asked a question,
anyway, she got the recommend signed for me.
Bishop Salisbury signed the recommend and sent it out to him so that they would ordain him an elder.
Interesting, huh? So
when you were in Hawaii, what was your ranking? I remember some of the photographs that I need to get you to label. You had said there were like three officers, or...
What?
How many officers were there in your unit, and what was your ranking there?
Well, it's not the, I was the commanding officer.
So you were in charge.
And what was your rank?
And my rank was the first lieutenant at that time.
Now, I've heard
that... Before I came home, I was commissioned a captain. But my outfit consisted of myself and four enlisted men underneath of me. And I reported directly to the general, because I had a radar maintenance unit that consisted of just of five people.
Weren't you set to go out on the next wave if the war wouldn't have ended? Didn't you have orders that you would be leaving and going somewhere else or something?
Yeah, you got somebody to do it for him, didn't you?
No.
Well, I don't know whether I know you. I'm sure you heard of it. When I went back after getting married, we left on a Sunday afternoon, and we were supposed to be in Boston and report in for duty there at 8 o'clock. Somewhere in New York, we ran out of gas in the middle of the night, and we couldn't get into town. We had to put, we luckily, I think we could push on the level and go down some hills, and we finally got into the town where they sold gas, and we got some gas and got back to the base where we were supposed to be in there by 8 o'clock. We got in at something like 5 or 6 o'clock in the morning, and I was looking on the bulletin board, and it said anybody with a MOS number of, say, 1255, report to the colonel. They need people to go, people that are trained and experienced and qualification, go to radar school in Florida. So I went in, and Bob Campbell and I, he didn't go back with me, but he was there reporting in. We were both scheduled to go over to Europe as replacements, and some of my friends, in fact my bunkmate, was killed over there in the Battle of the Bulge. But I got on the plane, or on the train, and went to Florida. When I got on to Florida, that's where I went to radar school, and that's where, when I was down there, that I called up Mom and got her to come down. And she had to wait until you finished.
Yes, but over in Hawaii, after you got sent to Hawaii and they dropped the bombs, you did find out that you had been, your unit had been scheduled to go in on the second wave, I think you said.
And the second wave of troops when we invaded the city of Tokyo. And and one of my officers that was my roommate in the house that we lived in, he said, "Boy, you're lucky to get to go over." Oh, but after the bomb dropped, then the orders were canceled for where we were going to go.
Yeah.
But
and he was supposed to go to Okinawa.
I was supposed to go to Okinawa, and he said, "I sure wish I was going to Okinawa." And I said, "If you want to go to Okinawa, you just tell the colonel